Good afternoon and welcome to you all. If I could ask you to please stay standing just for a few minutes. I'm Lindsay Gordon. I'm the Chancellor of the University of British Columbia. And would you please join us in singing O Canada, led by our University Marshal Nancy Hermiston, who's the Director of the Opera and Voice Program at the UBC School of Music. Thank you, Nancy. We pause for a moment to give thanks, spiritual and temporal, for the blessings we share in this wonderful world, this great country, this blessed province, this splendid university. And we respectfully acknowledge the traditions and customs of the Okanagan Nation and its people, in whose traditional territories we are gathered today. We give thanks to these proud students, their friends and family on this most memorable occasion. And please be seated. So welcome again, and thank you, Principal Buzzard, distinguished visitors, and members of the platform party. Now, some of you may have noticed that Martha Piper, our president, is not with us today. I'm very sorry to tell you that she broke her ankle yesterday and so is unable to attend. She obviously extends her sincere apologies, but she will be with us in spirit, of course. And of course, the show must go on, so I'm delighted that our Okanagan principal, Deborah Buzzard, will be stepping in to very capably fill the role that Martha would otherwise play. So welcome and congratulations to all of you, graduating students, and to all those who helped you reach this milestone today. Faculty, staff, students, friends, family, your supporters, and of course, for your parents, there's no greater investment in life than in your children's education. So please, let's applaud them all. As UBC celebrates its 100th anniversary and the Okanagan campus its 10th anniversary, my very brief message to you today is about the importance of learning from and celebrating our history and our heritage. Indeed, there's an additional element of distinction for today's congregation ceremony, because it's exactly 100 years ago in the spring of 1916 that UBC held its first graduation class. So actually, that makes you the final graduating class of UBC's first century. So congratulations. In 1916, there were just 40 graduates. And in his invocation address to the graduating class, the first president of UBC, Frank Westbrook exhorted students to make our province and our world a better place in which to live. And almost 50 years later, President Norman Mackenzie said, and I quote, "In some ways, our history is a record of perpetual frustration. We never had enough staff, buildings, money, facilities of any kind. But we've always had the one surplus that is desirable, a greater demand for education than our facilities could cope with." So in spite of UBC having changed from a small provincial university with 40 alumni to today a global center of research and innovation with more than 310,000 alumni, I really believe that the messages of Presidents Westbrook and Mackenzie are as appropriate today as they were when first said. We began life in temporary wooden buildings in Fairview. And today we have a magnificent university in two of the most beautiful sites in the world. And the future of UBC will be remarkable. Now, we may never fully be able to meet the demand that President Mackenzie spoke of, but our university will continue to grow and evolve as it meets the expectations of a new world in a new century. And just as UBC is on the cusp of a new century, you too are on the cusp of a new beginning. You are our future. Of course, you will inevitably face some challenges from time to time, which may seem overwhelming. But I know that each of you is capable of succeeding and making our world a better place. And as you go through life, you will undoubtedly experience some disappointment. But the only failure is the failure to try, and the real measure of success is how we cope with disappointment. And I'm sure during your years at UBC, you've probably experienced the odd moment of disappointment. I know I did when I was in your position here many, many years ago. But when I look back on those experiences, I honestly believe that they are the experiences that I learned the most from. I learned to be open and flexible to new opportunities, but not to lose sight of my goal. So work hard, be persistent, be imaginative, learn from your mistakes, stay focused, have some fun, but above all, pursue your passion, whatever that may be. And as graduates of this great university, continue to play your role in helping to build a diverse, inclusive, and better community. Understand the obligations that we owe to one another in a civil society, and not just to our neighbors at home, but to strangers from afar. Your education is a gift, so use it wisely, and use it to make a meaningful contribution to society, no matter how small or large that may be. And I do encourage you to stay to continue and to carry on with your lifelong learning journey and stay connected to UBC as you join the hundreds of thousands of alumni who have preceded you. And I truly hope that you enjoy this memorable occasion, and I would personally like to offer you my heartfelt congratulations on meeting this milestone of life, your graduation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chancellor. I'm Deborah Buzzard, and I have the distinct pleasure and privilege of serving as the Deputy Vice Chancellor of UBC and the principal of our beautiful Okanagan campus. Every year at Convocation, UBC has the honor of bestowing honorary degrees upon individuals who, in the opinion of the university community, have fit the criteria of excellence and eminence in their field. Roberta Bondar exemplifies these characteristics, and I invite her now to step forward to receive her honorary degree. Mr. Chancellor, as an astronaut aboard NASA's Space Shuttle Discovery in 1992, Dr. Roberta Bondar orbited Earth 129 times in 8 days and traveled more than 4.7 million kilometers. During that mission, she conducted more than 40 investigations from scientists in 13 countries, including space physiology experiments from UBC, and made history as the first Canadian woman astronaut and the world's first neurologist in space. Dr. Bondar has inspired generations of future scientists, doctors, teachers, and people who dare to dream, train, and achieve great things. She is a creative thinker, physician and scientist, photographer and author, environmental interpreter, an educator, pioneering astronaut, and a truly passionate earthling. A Canadian board-certified neurologist with a subspecialty in neuro-ophthalmology, Dr. Bondar has made groundbreaking discoveries in space medicine. For more than a decade, she headed an international research team studying the effects on astronauts of spaceflight and readaptation back to Earth's gravity. One of the most academically distinguished astronauts to have flown in space, Dr. Bondar is also an acclaimed photographer of the environment, whose in-flight role as part of NASA's Earth observation team included photographing our planet. She is the author of 3 best-selling photo essay books featuring her photography of the surface of the Earth, and her photographic works are in private, corporate, and institutional collections in Canada, the United States, and England. She co-founded the Roberta Bondar Foundation, a not-for-profit charitable organization to reconnect us to the natural environment. Dr. Bondar was born in Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, and studied zoology and agriculture at the University of Guelph. She completed a Master's of Science in Experimental Pathology at the University of Western Ontario before earning a PhD in Neurobiology from the University of Toronto and an MD from McMaster University. An officer of the Order of Canada and a holder of the NASA Space Medal, Dr. Bondar was inducted into the International Women's Forum Hall of Fame and the Canadian Medical Hall of Fame for her research. She is also a fellow of both the Royal Society of Canada and the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons. Mr. Chancellor, in recognition of her extraordinary and inspiring contributions to science, a lifelong passion for learning and sharing knowledge, I ask that you confer the degree of Doctor of Science honoris causa upon Roberta Lynn Bondar.
By the authority of the Okanagan Senate of this university, I confer upon you, Roberta Bondar, the title and degree Doctor of Science honoris causa.
It gives me great pleasure to now ask Dr. Bondar to say a few words. Dr. Bondar.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chancellor, Madam Deputy Vice
Chancellor, Principal, Acting President.
Thank you very much. I'd like to really thank the University of British Columbia Okanagan campus for allowing me to share the stage with my fellow graduates today. It's a time in our life that we can never repeat, and I'm absolutely thrilled from the bottom of my heart to be able to do that with each and every one of you. Thank you so much. I also want to thank my friends and colleagues on the launch platform here for all the good work that they have done to be able to share with you the knowledge base and wisdom and insight that they have, not just with their own individual subjects, but how they think. Because it's really how you think is what you walk away with. That is my feeling. Now, I've had a one or two university degrees, so I kind of understand how you're feeling right now, and I won't speak too long, but I do feel that it's very important, besides connecting with you through the space experiments I did on behalf of the University of British Columbia, but also to maybe to provide you just a couple of little pearls of wisdom you might want to tuck away somewhere. And the Chancellor's mentioned passion, and I would like to speak to you about passion and purpose just for a couple of minutes before they haul me off the stage. Passion is something that drives us, but it's really the strategy you put in place that's going to define you. Passion without a strategy is not going to help you in the long run, except to feel that you're doing something, but you don't want to just be spinning your wheels. You want to bring other people into the passionate view you have of the world. You want to be able to make society better and a better place to be because of that passion you've had for whatever it is. So I just wanted to give you four little things to think about. I firmly believe that if we all had crystal balls when we were teenagers, we wouldn't believe what was in the crystal ball. In fact, it might discourage a lot of people to look in a crystal ball. Trust me, when I was in high school, I was going to be a science and a phys ed teacher. It changed my life when I developed mumps in third year university. I had no strategy. I was there left because my strategy I had in place had suddenly evaporated. The course that I was to take was canceled at this other university. I was going to do an honors bachelor of science degree, and then I was going to do this bachelor of physical and health education. They canceled that one-year program, and I had mumps. Paralyzed my right arm. I had to stop playing on the university basketball team. I couldn't coach the university archery team. I couldn't shoot a bow. I couldn't even continue my flight lessons because I couldn't move my hand up to pull the throttle back on the cockpit. You can see I can move it now. All of those things kind of like suddenly came out of nowhere. So when we look at a crystal ball, sometimes we don't know what that path should be to get to where it is that we're going to go. So I would say to you that you need to do a few things. One is that you need to think about your passion, but you need to think about how you're going to recognize the opportunity for it when it comes. And so diversity, that was also mentioned by the Chancellor, is actually the key to it all. People ask me all the time, and there's no silver bullet here, there's no way you can walk in my shoes or anyone else's, you have your own path to create. I do firmly believe that you can make luck happen, however. And I mentioned this once to someone, and they said, that's impossible. And I said, okay, I put a $50 bill down on the ground, what do you say? Hey, it's my lucky day. But if you don't pick the bill up, is it your lucky day, or have you bypassed an opportunity? So we have to be able to recognize the opportunity. We have to be prepared with the wonderful skill set you started with here, that your personal and professional lives somehow can become intertwined. And that diversity of skills has to be built onto recognizing an opportunity. And that recognition of an opportunity is diversity of time and space. Then you move from there. And you think about it, yeah, I can see this opportunity to be an astronaut, 1983. I don't know how many of you were born there, I don't want to know right now. But trust me, back in 1983, without the internet, it was up through the radio, television, or a newspaper, remember those, to have an ad that you applied to. So I recognized that opportunity, but did I have the skills? Yeah, I had the skills. I could have bypassed that opportunity. I could have looked at it and said, yeah, that's something I always wanted to do, but you know, I'm just not sure. So if the opportunity comes up, and there'll be many of them in our lives, we may have to pass up one at one particular point, and then move on to the next one and the next one, so we have this diversity of time and space for opportunity. But then we have to not only just recognize the opportunity, we have to have the courage to act. And that courage requires diversity of depth. You as a person. Because remember, the whole of your life, you're going to be creating you. I'm still creating me. There was that 1983 me when I applied to the space program, was so naive about stuff. And then there was the 1991 Roberta Bonder, who injured her neck during space training and had to have emergency neurosurgery to have her neck fused before they'd allow her to be rocketed into space. And so my whole world that I had been building up using for years, pardon me, almost disappeared again. But the idea to have the courage and the depth of things you need to know that you have the self-confidence. But I also caution you, there's a little tale about your family that we already applauded today, your support systems, brothers, sisters, nieces, nephews, very good friends. Your support system is always going to be with you, but be careful as you drag them into your slipstream. Always remember that they have sensitivities to things that are in a world outside of where you think you're going. So try to understand their risk and their role in your life as well. So when we look at the idea of having depth and diversity of depth, to have the courage to actually take that opportunity, the final piece, the fourth piece, is the execution of it. And that requires the diversity of outcomes. So when you are well prepared, you recognize an opportunity, have the courage to act on that opportunity, and then you look at the outcomes you can have. All of those things depend on diversity. It's not just your education here at the university, in class, in lecture theaters, in a library, on the internet. It's also your interpersonal skills. It's the way you meet other people. It's the way you interact and you give them a good handshake, unless you have a tendon injury like me and I do fist bumps now. But you have to understand that people don't know you. They don't know the 2016 you. They may meet the 2000 or 2026 you or the 2017 you, but they don't meet you as we know you today. So when you meet people, you have to give them your best and you have to listen to them as well. There is not one person whom you will meet who does not have something to offer you. And in exchange, you have something to offer them. So I leave you those four little pearls of wisdom from me. They've served me well in my life. And as I get older and older, and hopefully wiser and wiser, the me that I'm creating is one that even has more insight, so that the next time we meet, and you have to come up and say hello, if you see me in the airport and still recognize me without these clothes on, if you recognize me, come and tell me that you were here at the UBC and you graduated with me. I would be thrilled to give you a great UBC hug. All the best.
Thank you, Dr. Bonder, for those inspirational and wise words. And I think that's the biggest offer of a hug I've ever heard. So be prepared. As most of you know, we're celebrating our 100th anniversary this year. The university opened in 1915. But it was a march known as the Great Trek that took place in 1922 that set this university on its course to greatness. On Saturday, October the 28th, 1922, 1,178 UBC students, that was almost the entire student body at the time, marched from downtown Vancouver to Point Grey to demand that the provincial government of the day build them a university. It was an amazing act of vision, solidarity, political will, and determination. And while the Great Trek is universally applauded as an example of student activism at its best, there is a piece of history associated with the march that few know, and this is it. As the students left the skeleton of the science building that was in construction at the time, they stopped and tossed stones into the base of a hollow cairn. Stones representing not only their individual contributions to that march, but also their support for the building of a great university to serve the people of British Columbia, Canada, and the world. That cairn is still there today on Main Mall in Vancouver. It sits between the Chemistry Building and the Sorda School of Business. The individual stones symbolizing individual contributions. What the students in 1922 understood was this, that each of them individually had a responsibility to act, that they could not wait for others to take up the cause, that they could not rely on institutions, associations, or even their government to make things happen. But rather, they knew that things would change only if they joined their individual strength and made their collective voice heard, thus assuming a responsibility collectively to do the right thing. And you are the inheritors of that tradition, the students of UBC here in the Okanagan. And you have shown that spirit of student engagement and involvement is very much alive on our young campus. Recognizing the urgent need for study space, and how many of you have had to wait for a table to become available or a plug-in in our library to write that very urgent term paper, you have committed by referendum during your time here to contribute $100 million towards the construction of new learning and study space to meet the needs of the next century here. Like the Vancouver students of 1922, you've shown your determination to act, to work together in the best interest of our university. The new teaching and learning extension of our library will be your cairn, a permanent recognition of your collective action and something for which we all thank you. As you graduate from the University of British Columbia, I know that the world that you're entering appears to have numerous insurmountable problems. Over the past several years, the foundations of our society have been shaken by a number of disturbing events: the rise of international terrorism and the carnage that comes in its wake, the ongoing conflicts in the Middle East, and the flood of refugees coming from that troubled region, the debates around climate change, and the growing number of natural disasters, such as the devastating fire that struck our neighbors in Alberta. Such events may suggest that no one person can bring order to chaos or succeed in resolving these seemingly intractable conflicts and challenges. Yet what is so clear through the examples of student engagement in Vancouver and Kelowna is this: by working hard and together, each person is able to have a large impact. By collaborating with others who have the same aspirations, by putting your stone into the cairn, you are able to make things happen and to change the course of history. The organizers of that march in 1922 were themselves aware of this. Abe Richards, then president of the Student Society, said at the time, "Let the cairn stand not for dedication, not as a memorial to our efforts, but as a landmark for the future." Jennifer Welsh, a Canadian who's a professor of international relations at Oxford University, wrote in her book titled At Home in the World, Canada's Global Vision for the 21st Century, that solutions to the problems of the world are not solely the responsibility of policymakers or government leaders. Rather, she suggests that we all share a responsibility to act, and maintains that being a Canadian means assuming our role in the world stage and in our local community as model citizens. Model citizens, I like that term. It may be a little old-fashioned, but lest you think that I'm talking about someone else, someone famous, think again. I'm talking about you, you UBC students who've made your mark here already at UBC. For example, this year, you voted overwhelmingly in favor of extending financial support for refugees who choose to come and study on our UBC campus here in the Okanagan. What a wonderful forward-thinking gift to leave behind as you graduate. Thank you all so much for that. Your time at UBC has prepared you to be those model citizens, people able to work together and solve some of the most pressing problems, people who can focus not on what divides us, but what we have in common, people willing to drop their stone into the cairn, assisting and working together to achieve success for all and to create a better world. As UBC enters its second century, I am confident that you, the graduates who straddle both centuries of UBC's existence, will indeed write history. You have an example of the students who've gone before you who did just that, who wrote a significant chapter of the university's early history, and by doing so, had a profound impact on this province and the hundreds of thousands of students who had followed them. It is in honor of those great trekkers and in celebration of our centennial that you will receive a small gift at the end of today's ceremony. When you exit the hall, you'll be given a small token to remind you of all those who have gone before you and the role you can and must play as a UBC graduate in being the model citizens of tomorrow and making the world the way we wish it to be. And so today, we celebrate you. You are UBC. It is in this context that I offer my most sincere congratulations on this very happy occasion and my best wishes for your own health, happiness, and personal fulfillment. We all wish you every future success. Congratulations. I'm pleased at this time to call upon Alyssa Penner, a member of the graduating class, to make remarks. Alyssa.
Chancellor, Deputy Vice Chancellor and Principal, honored guests and fellow graduates, I feel very privileged to be standing before you today and speaking on behalf of the graduating class. I feel privileged because today is a very exciting day, which represents years of hard work. This room is full of students who have dedicated time, money, energy, and creativity in order to make it to this day, where we get to recognize all that we have accomplished over the past four or more years. So first of all, I would like to congratulate my peers. Graduating from university is something to be very proud of, and it provides a great opportunity for transition, whether that's into further education, a career, or another new adventure. But before you hurry to cross this stage and conquer the world, I would like to remind you to stop and to take a look around yourself. As brilliant and talented as we know we all are, I think we can recognize that none of us has made it here on our own. Alongside of us, all of this way, there have been family members and friends, teachers and mentors who have played an important role in our academic experience. They've offered us guidance, instruction, encouragement, humor, and probably some much needed financial support. Many of these people are here today, supporting us once again, sitting through a long graduation ceremony, waiting for just one moment when they get to cheer as their graduate crosses the stage. Without these people, we may not have arrived at this point. So don't forget to say thank you. Take time to recognize the people who are in your life, both now and in the future, and let them know that you're grateful for them. As a representative of all of the graduates here, I would like to say thank you to everyone who has come to support us today, both today and throughout our academic journeys thus far. You truly have made a difference in our lives. And back to the graduates who are going to conquer the world. I don't know what the future holds for you, but I do know that having completed at least a portion of your academic experience, the choice is yours. University can teach you many skills, but those won't matter at all if you don't choose to apply them in the real world. So I encourage you to dream, to set goals, and to take action to make those dreams become a reality. And I will remind you once again that you're not alone. Along with your personal support system of mentors and cheerleaders, you're also part of a new community as a graduate of UBCO. On behalf of alumni UBC, I am honored to welcome you into the alumni family. You now belong to a community of changemakers and leaders, more than 310,000 strong. Graduates like you who want to make a positive difference in the world. So congratulations, class of 2016. Your next adventure awaits. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alyssa. Will the candidates for degrees please rise? Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting the candidates for degrees who have successfully completed their studies and fulfilled the conditions that the university has set for them. The Okanagan Senate of this university recommends them to you for the degrees that will be announced by a representative of the faculties. As each degree is officially conferred, the dean of the faculty, and in the case of graduate students, the acting dean of the College of Graduate Studies will congratulate the student. Melissa McHugh and Dan Toolsey, members of the alumni community, will welcome each student to the Alumni Association and present them with an alumni handbook. The candidates will please be seated.
Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you the candidates for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, Abu Hena M.D. Muntasir Bila. Abu Hena Bila developed a new performance-based seismic design guideline for bridge piers using novel-shaped memory alloys. This research will offset a substantial amount of repair and maintenance costs that are incurred with conventional highway bridges and will develop generate sustainable highway bridges in Canada. Dr. Bila. Sheller Ebrahimi. Sheller Ebrahimi experimentally developed and mathematically modeled a sustainable method for the removal of nitrate from drinking water using the concept of combined ion exchange and resin biogeneration. Her findings had made major contributions in the field of nitrate treatment of contaminated drinking water sources, especially in small communities. Dr. Ebrahimi. Alireza Qaisi. Alireza Qaisi studied the reliability of water distribution systems under simultaneous multi-pipe failure scenario. He developed advanced models of higher state, multi-state, and multi-aspect reliability analyses to ensure the long-term reliable operation of water distribution systems. Dr. Qaisi. Craig Rodney Hosland. Craig Hosland verified the mold-induced respiratory health effects may be reversed through a residential healthcare prevention program. His research included the development of a first-of-its-kind tool to reliably link and measure occupant health effects from damp and moldy indoor environments. The results further advanced healthcare prevention methods. Dr. Hosland. Niloufar Islam. Niloufar Islam developed 6 decision-making tools to help in selecting the location and dosages for booster chlorination in water distribution networks. The research focused primarily on small to medium-sized distribution networks that lack continuous monitoring, resources, and technical expertise, but require dynamic solutions for booster chlorination. The study provides solution for balancing microbiological and disinfectant byproducts related to chemical water quality. Dr. Islam. Ghulam Kabir. Ghulam Kabir developed a Bayesian framework for the repair and replacement action program of water mains considering different levels of uncertainties. This framework will provide information at the operation level and network level and help utility engineers and managers predict suitable new installation and or rehabilitation programs, as well as their corresponding costs for effective and proactive decision making. Dr. Kabir. Saber Moradi. Saber Moradi studied three-dimensional computer modeling of post-tension steel beam column connection for seismic regions. Moradi used the developed modeling techniques to optimize the structural response of these connections and investigated the effect of varied design factors on a connection behavior. The results of this research are useful for the design and practical adoption of post-tension connection in a steel building. Dr. Moradi. Samuel Nunu. Samuel Nunu developed a Bayesian belief network model tool to manage open pit slopes in British Columbia. The research integrated available geotechnical engineering data and knowledge into one platform that can establish appropriate operational responses to predicted states of pit wall movement. This tool will allow BC mine operators to move effectively manage pit operation. Dr. Nunu. Johannes Schneider. Johannes Schneider studied the performance of connectors used in multi-story timber steel hybrid buildings to understand their resilience to seismic forces. Relevant for refining building codes, the results also inspired him to design and test a novel connection method that holds promise to improve safety and repairability of building after earthquake. Dr. Schneider. Fang Yang. Fang Yang studied the performance of terrestrial free space optical communication systems. He characterized the impact of several adverse effects on practical systems, which can help us to better understand the performance limiting factors in such systems. Dr. Yang. Amir Zare. Amir Zare developed remotely controlled drug delivery systems in the form of both pump-based devices and microparticle drug carriers. The systems are designed using nano and microtechnology by combining polymers and magnetic particles into biocompatible systems. The systems created by Zaher permit on-demand drug release, are simple to implant, and require minimal power. Dr. Zare. Hamid Rajani. Hamid Rajani developed a 3D multi-scale, multi-physics model to predict weld failure. This model, which is the first of its kind, allows engineers to optimize welding procedures to improve the performance and safety of welded structures. Dr. Rajani. Atusa Sultani. Atusa Sultani developed a decision support framework that guides multiple stakeholders with conflicting priorities to reach an agreement on the most sustainable and pragmatic waste treatment option. She used mathematical and decision-making methods to minimize the negative impacts of group decisions on engineering projects. Dr. Sultani.
Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you the candidates for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy. Lindsay Ann Balfour. Dr. Balfour examined the cultural responses to 9/11 and their engagement with the philosophy of hospitality. While the 9/11 cultural archive is often characterized by trauma, the suspicion of otherness, and the protection of the home and hearth, Dr. Balfour argues that these cultural works are significant because they reframe debates over the stranger and what it means to engage ethically with other times of terror. Dr. Lindsay Balfour. Sorry. Kelly Doyle. Dr. Kelly Doyle showed via post-human philosophy that the zombie figure exposes the limits of the discursive formulation of what it means to be human in the context of historical moments like 9/11. She argues that exploring the limits of the human prompts a consideration of the human capacity for ethics and social justice. Dr. Kelly Doyle. Yannick Haru Ekinar. Dr. Yannick studied the interplay between Salman Rushdie's persona and his novels. Rushdie's complex public presence limits how effectively his literature can challenge dominant cultural norms, and Dr. Yannick argues for a mode of reading Rushdie's work that could restore some of its social and political impact. Dr. Yannick Ekinar. Am I reading this one? Sorry. Alex Berlin Manuel, Masters of English. Oh, sorry. Jamie Lynn Isaac, Master of Arts. Sorry, what do you want? Okay, sorry. Carrie Ann Kersgaard, Master of Arts. Okay. That's it.
Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you the candidates for the degree of Master of Applied Science, Monica Angela Sella, Venkatesh Kumar Chinraj, Caleb Andrew Gortz, Fahmida Islam, Abdul Rahman Mahmoud Masood, Sadaf Muallemipur, Rehane Mogaddas Jafari, Oleg Shabarchin, Ki Zhang, Bhavesh Narendra Pai Patel, Bradley Reinholds, Zhuangquan Zhen, Abhinav Karanam, Nivedita Mahesh, Ryan Phillips, Seper Zarif Mansour, Liang Fang, Jaspreet Singh Gill, Vignesh Mohan. This is not me. It's not me. Just give me those tickets.
We don't have. Okay. Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you the candidates for the degree of Master of Fine Arts. And we don't have them? Oh, Jean Michael Corbett. Sorry.
Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you the candidates for the degree of Master of Science, Roya Samanipur. I'm done.
Hello, congratulations. Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Arts. Caitlin Robson, Cassandra Paige Van Sickle, Audrey Sarah McMahon, Shannon Welsh, Nicole Burns, Tristan Carter, Mark Dreger,
Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you the candidates for the degree of Master of Engineering. Hasnain Arshad, Omer Farooq, Adnan Akil Ahmad Bahad, Jagjeet Singh Dhillon,
Sorry. There we go. Musical.
Chair. This is fun. Hi. Brianna Dawn Ferguson, Bachelor of Arts. Aaron Hebert. Sasha Curry. Carrie Lee Galen. Lauren Ann Marshall. Brandon Shalansky. Earl Gerald Dulay. Haley Smith. Manami Miyako. Lauren Michelle Richardson. Julia Carol Cave. Misa Shimizu. Miranda Wilson. Kiara Louise Polzen. Stéphanie Bontorin. Catherine Codarso. Caitlin Morgan Hearn. Jade Elia Ma Verling. Justine Miner. Brittany Rhodes. Jaden Riddle. Jenny Ellen Robichaud. Liam Moram. Sarah Danica Wenz. Miriam Hazir. Megan Kimball. Samantha Baldwin. Jordan Kadak. Christopher Paul Kopp. Caitlin Marshall. Bailey Lynn Sallenbach. Lisa Marples. Lynette Oon. Rivsha Akshi Parahag. Lauren Marie Nixon. Haley Aylin Kaler. Dominique Ovas. Alyssa Penner. Paisley Newburn. Pamela Panza. Ayla Ann Fowler.
Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Applied Science, Reza Afzali. Christian Andres Arcila Barahona. Michael Bauerline. Matthew Blaze. Nelson Chapman. Justin Choi. Jordan Alexander Kuchman, Ian Alexander Cumming, Matthew Dorian, Kristen John Duncan, Trevor Engelsmeyer, Robin Andrew Forbes, Sarah Rebecca Foster, Sterling William Grasick, Matthew Gribbins, Mackie Gregory, Edward Huntington Haley, Nathan Hewlett, Stephen Hunter, Joel Jalinski, Matthew Thomas Jones, Karsten Kennedy, Siobhan Kurana, Youngjun Lee, Benjamin Jessel Lindemann, Curtis Main, Scott Michael McIntyre, Isaac Miller Hanneman, Ian Clark Purvis, Jennifer Rene Pin, Ernesto Renhefo, Stefan Renner, Shaheen Rezaei, Siobhan Marie Savard, Michael Schott, Cameron Allen James Still, Thomas Vandermeer, Cole Van Vliet, Devin Rodney Wallin, Zane Travis Will, Tanachud Wong Jairi Yakub, Mazhar Shah Ahmed, Connor Badowich, Ryan Matthew Bentley, Adrian Bowan, sorry about that, Raul Chuhan, Danny Chen, Timothy Cook, Tyler Ferguson, Taylor Foster, Jonas Gerzen, Graham Kostuk, Kennedy Kovacs, Tobias James Lindsay, Joshua McKinney, Scott William Milkarski, Braden Rogers, Maria Royston, Zeng K. Su, Benjamin Vogel, Todd Robert Williams, Fawaz Al-Nassar, David Andrews, Matthew Berrio, Leyland Bernier, Sharia Batajarji, Navdeep Barar. Maria Fazio Chatzombwa. Brian William Clark. Muhammad Shari Kodabux. Sam Douglas Deering. Christopher Michael Duarte. Kyle Francis Walter Dostovich. Levi Duby. Peter Flanagan. Narindel Gill. Matthew Hill. Corey Heisey. John Keegan Holm. Joshua Kyle Holt. Dustin Hoopner. Austin George Hunter. Muhammad Hazwan Hasni. Lawrence Lincoln Johnson. Stephen Makwa Kimanzi. Evan Michael Kingston. Lucas Sebastian Kocher. Levi C. LaFortune. Christopher LeBlanc. James Robert McSween. Oh, yeah. Mitchell James Patrick McConaughey. Elizabeth McKinley. Kyle Mears. Justin Mock. Yashar Musafiri. Noor Amira Marshila Muzir. Devin Lee Nakatsu. Conrad Neufeld. Maria Newman. Chibuza Nukeze. Luke Oman. Steven Oleksin. Mariah Olson. Andrew Olson. Odeja Oyalesi. Kyle Parhar. Justin Jerry Lee Pachas. Gianfranco Paletta. Thomas Alexander Penner. Campbell Rayfuse. Riley Reese. Kieran Rogers.
Thank you.
Tyler Jordan Roth. Ahmed Shah Ridzwan Shahrudin. Brooklyn Sheptak. Grant Sonnenberg. Logan Bryce Taylor. Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you the University of BC Medal in Engineering, head of the graduating class, Logan Terry. Za Tharu. Brad J. Van Hannigan.
Levi Verlin. Reed Wagner. Matthew Williams. Austin Winters. Hunter Wojak. Graham Anthony Markham Wood. David Woolley. Momchil Yordanov.
Mr. Chancellor, I have the pleasure of presenting to you now, thank you, the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Fine Arts. Marielle Bélanger. Ashesh Vong Contractor. Allison Gill. The head of graduating class, Emily McMillan. Shawning Drew. Marissa Gailey. Rebecca Harrison. Boaz Walk. Michelle McKay. Ryan Roman. Esther Gabrielle Roy Cloutier. Brittany Spanky. Magdalena Jane Wilson. Kelly Lynn Allen. Jia Chen. Asher John Clayson.
For those graduates who have crossed the stage today, as well as those who are unable to attend today's ceremony, I hereby admit you to the convocation of UBC. Congratulations. Can I ask the graduates to please rise? So it's been my great pleasure to meet each and every one of you today walking across the stage, members of the graduating class. You put a huge amount of time, effort, commitment, energy to reach this milestone. You've had quite a bit of help, I think, along the way, and it would be a great moment just to turn around and show your appreciation to your friends, family, supporters out there in the audience. And how about a round of applause for the faculty on stage? So having crossed this stage today, you are now members of the Convocation of UBC. And you are in good company. Since UBC first began granting degrees 100 years ago, more than 310,000 men and women have crossed the stage, just like this one, to receive their degrees, and they've gone on to help shape our society. And as alumni, your relationship with UBC is beginning anew. You can maintain your voice in the affairs of the university through your elected members of Senate, perhaps by mentoring some of today's students, or by participating in one of the many volunteer activities that are available both here at home and abroad. And as lifelong learners, you are always welcome to come back and take a course or two. You might want to take a short break before you do that, but you will always be welcome to come back here. And I do encourage you to stay connected to this great institution, because UBC still has much to offer you, and you still have much to offer UBC. So 2MS, congratulations, and please be seated. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chancellor. The Governor General's Academic Medal was first awarded in 1873 by the Earl of Dufferin and has since become one of the most prestigious awards that a student in a Canadian educational institution may receive. Today, we will present the Governor General's Gold Medal to the student whose academic record, in the opinion of the College of Graduate Studies, is the best in the graduating class for a doctoral or master's degree. This year, the gold medal goes to Abu Henna Billa. Would Dr. Billa please come forward? Dr. Billa distinguished himself at UBC as an outstanding master's and doctoral candidate known for academic excellence, hard work, imagination, and extraordinary intellectual capacity. His PhD research in the School of Engineering focused on the development of design guidelines for highway bridges using smart materials, building on his involvement with research related to seismic rehabilitation of structures and the application of smart materials. Prior to his master's and PhD studies here, he was an undergraduate and then lecturer in the Department of Civil Engineering at the Military Institute of Science and Technology in Bangladesh. There he earned the MIST medal for obtaining the highest undergraduate grade point average in civil engineering. He's consistent, you have to give him that. Dr. Billa has received many awards and scholarships, including a Natural Sciences and Engineering Research Council Industrial Postgraduate Scholarship, the Graduate Dean's Thesis Fellowship, UBC and School of Engineering Graduate Fellowships, and the Research Excellence Award from his research group in the School of Engineering. Today, in recognition of his outstanding work as a graduate student, the Governor General's Gold Medal is awarded to Dr. Billa. Ladies and gentlemen, this brings our ceremony to a close. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I, and that all of you will be able to join us for refreshments, which will be served immediately following the ceremony in the courtyard outside. One last word to our centennial graduates. A small reminder of your heritage will be waiting for you as you exit the gymnasium. Please make sure that you stop and pick it up. And the next time you're in Vancouver, I'd like to suggest that you visit the UBC campus there and check out the cairn, and then go visit the new Robert H. Lee Alumni Center, a new home for all UBC alumni. And I'd ask, please, guests and family to remain in their places until the academic procession and the graduates have left the building. Thank you all for joining us for what's been a wonderful day. I know you'll join me once again in congratulating the centennial graduates of the University of British Columbia. Well done.